Okay, so we are live now. So it's 10:30 and let's get started. Welcome everyone to the next episode of GCPP Prime Time, weekly dose of current affairs and interesting policy issues that we've been discussing over the past 14 or 15 weeks. So for those of you who are not familiar with GCPP, the acronym GCPP stands for Graduate Certificate in Public Policy, and that's our flagship course that Takshashila runs for basics of public policy and economic reasoning. And the motive behind this GCPP Prime Time was that we were having a lot of these interesting discussions in the GCPP classroom, and we thought it would be good if we could open up some of these discussions to a larger audience, and that's the genesis of the GCPP Prime Time. So welcome to this next session of GCPP Prime Time. Just a few housekeeping rules before we get started. So since we are on Google Hangouts, I will not be able to unmute you and listen to your questions. So instead, it would be good if you can list your questions on Twitter with hashtag GCPP Prime Time or on the YouTube live chat window, and Raman is here who will pick up these questions, and then we can take some of them towards the end. Okay, so let's get started. So recently, the India-Iran relations are in the spotlight, and because of the Chabahar agreement, which was signed recently during the Indian PM's visit there. So we thought of taking up that topic for today's discussion. And to discuss that today, we have Sumitha, who is an associate research fellow at Rajaratnam School of International Studies in Singapore. Her work focuses on India's foreign policy and security policies towards the Middle East and particularly Iran. She also understands Farsi and has also traveled to Iran. So, hi, Sumitha.
Hi. Hi, Pranay. Lovely to be here. Thanks for having me.
Thanks, Sumitha. So, I am Pranay. I am a research fellow at the Takshashila Institution, and I have been researching on Afghanistan, Pakistan, and hence my interest towards what Iran is doing. So, that's the background. So, let's get started. So, before we go into Chabahar and the deal and ask Sumitha to talk about it, I can just run you through a really brief history of Iran just to put things in perspective. So, the diplomatic relations between India and Iran began in 1950, and during the Shah's rule, Iran remained close to the US while India was mostly on the other side of the equation. So, the relationship was mostly frosty. And then in 1979, when Iran went through what was called the Cultural Revolution, it changed not only their government, but it also changed their state. So the Islamic Republic of Iran came into being, a new constitution was written, a completely new governance structure emerged. And then Ayatollah Khomeini returned back to Iran, and interestingly, he had an Indian connection as well. So there's a nice story there. His grandfather was born in India. He served under the Nawab of Awadh in and his surname was Musavi Hindi. So this was this what happened after this was that. Even the Khomeini returned when Khomeini returned back, Indian government actually sent a delegation to meet Khomeini, and then he only to be turned down because he didn't want his Indian connections to come in between the consolidation of power that was taking place in Iran at that time. So, anyways, that was the Indian connection there. After 1979, Iran's connection with India and India's need for Iran has mostly been based on energy considerations. Also, during the resistance to Northern Alliance, to the Taliban, India and Iran did work together in supporting the Northern Alliance. And thereafter, as I said, energy became the main consideration. In 2012, until 2012, Iran was the second largest crude oil supplier for India. And in 2012, what happened was US again imposed new sanctions, and that caused a big change in the governance of Iran again. Iran's political structure changed. The supreme leader Khamenei endorsed a moderate candidate in Hassan Rouhani in 2013, and subsequently, things started to change. Iran P5+1 deal was finalized, and a few sections have now been lifted. So now we have entered this phase where Iran is getting reintegrated into the world economy, and hence you see a lot of people visiting Iran. And in that context, the Indian PM also visited there, and then there was this deal signed. So let's dive into what this deal was and why is it important. So Sumitha, I believe there were 12 agreements signed between the two governments, including the Chabahar port. And it was such a big, big deal that you even announced on Facebook that you might end up distributing sweets. So what are these agreements about and why are they important?
Thank you for bringing that particular point up. But I guess for me, it was more because I've been following Chabahar, this whole transit track in the India-Iran relationship for at least 3 years now, over 3 years. So to see it actually reach a stage where it's actually the starting line of the race, it's only the starting point. You only have a basic commercial contract between India and Iran. They have set a specific timeline, is all that the Joint Secretary for Iran, Pakistan, Afghanistan, Iran Joint Secretary, who manages these three countries, could revealed during the press conference as well. So we're definitely looking for more details to emerge hopefully sooner on what that timeline looks like. And so there's a basic commercial contract, and these 12 other agreements also include, you know, cultural exchanges, diplomats, training. So I'm going to not go into those bits, but of course the bilateral commercial contract, most important. You have a couple of documents also on the export-import banks. Line of credit for not just the port but also the rail links, which are which will be if things go according to plan, be constructed by India to connect Chabahar northwards to Zayedan and into Afghanistan, all part of the trilateral arrangement. So there is the bilateral port and then the extended the trilateral agreement, which also involves Afghanistan and diving into Afghan territory. So
okay. Sumitha, just to interrupt, so you were talking about this credit, line of credit. So this was the big problem for Iran, isn't it? That they were not able to get access to credit because of the sanctions earlier. So has that problem now gone away? What is the status of that? And is it easier for India to trade with Iran or cooperate with them?
Okay, I think, so yes, what dealing with Iran means a whole bunch of monetary issues. I think that's what's holding back many aspects here as well. But the line of credit is coming from the Indian side. And of course, can India sustain that? Again, it's another question I've seen tossed around in the long term, because, you know, as years go by and projects get delayed, you know, the price also goes up. So that's one aspect. But I think the main aspect where the Iranians are not able to get hold of their money is on the oil side, on oil dues. So I think the main issue, and there are different sides to the story, the Iranians still believe that the Americans have not completely given the green or encouraged European banks, forget the Americans, because no American is supposed to still deal with Iran. So the Europeans have not yet, I guess, come forward with as much, it's not as amicable as they would like it to be, and that's what's affecting, especially in the oil deals. And you had it with the 6.5. With the amount that India also had to pay. And that only a part of it, I think a day or two just before Modi left, was when a part of it was solved by sending it through Turkey's Halbank. So that's, I think that's still an issue, which I think now will be slowly resolved.
So Sumitha, why is Chabahar important? What is Chabahar? Why should we care about it?
So I mean, it's very easily the fact that India, to access or to even connect itself to Iran or Central Asia and beyond, even extending to Europe, to, you know, the West and Russia to the East, you need to go through Iran because of Pakistan is not as easy a partner to work with, as we know. And so far, in the connection to Afghan goods and Indian goods going to Afghanistan, for Afghan goods to get to India, it has to go through either from Karachi or the Wagah border, the Wagah outpost. So giving Afghanistan an alternate route was also a part of the idea. It's been, from 2003, it's been a concrete idea of sorts. So it's come, 13 years now. So, 13 years, which is quite a long period by itself. And talking about Chabahar, it's located in the southeastern end of Iran, on the Makran coast, which also moves into Pakistan as well. Very close, quite close to the Pakistan border as well, so another consideration for Indians setting up their assets and equipment and people on the ground. It's located in the Sistan or Balochistan province. Though not talked about much, it's because you get more news on Pakistani Balochistan, you don't hear as much, especially in the English media, on Iranian Balochistan. But it does have its own set of issues on the ground, not extremely visible, but it's definitely there. So once India dives into actually breaking ground and, you know, work on the ground, there will be some considerations on how the local population views and engages with these projects as well.
Yeah. So for our viewers, Sistan-o-Balochistan is the Sunni-dominated region in Iran, right? So
yeah.
And it's a restive province there as well. So there are expected problems which might come up when the construction begins. So that is what Sumitha was talking about. So Sumitha, was China also a contender here? Because I remember Nirmala Sitharaman tweeting after this that, you know, China was also a contender and we actually managed to beat them to this post. That was very unusual for a minister to take the name of a country in such a deal. But was China also involved?
There was something which struck me, because I've also seen how different media reports in the last 3 years had different... it was very hard to nail down what the specifications of the contract are unless you get very exact information from the officials. And I constantly saw two berths. I think that's what we all saw. Two berths with some cargo. I mean, it was very vague, of course, but two berths was the number, which now has become two terminals and five berths.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm guessing if you had a shipping or a logistics expert, maybe, you know, it could make a difference. But I'm thinking there was something there. I think China was also trying to get get a share of the pie. But we'll have to deep dive into the China factor, perhaps separately, because that's, I think, something, a relationship on its own, a dynamic, which is actually way before the India, before we have seriously started looking at Chabahar. China has been there setting up not just industries and businesses, but also doing some strategic thinking and long-term thinking, which I think India needs to realize it needs to place to its strengths and not always, or we'll always be playing a catch-up game, which I don't think we need to indulge in.
But was China also going to get involved in Chabahar? There were some news reports, isn't it?
Yeah, I think at some point, I mean, there's information which comes from the Chinese ambassador delegation visiting Chabahar. You also get information from the Iranians and the officials who are trying to get India to move faster. So it's you get different noises regarding what China's exactly doing. I know for sure that in the last 2 months, China has decided to build an industrial town in Chabahar's vicinity, and it has launched that program. So that's definitely happening. They were, I believe, looking at berths, but, you know, I mean, if they can get enough to do in the industrial and the free trade zone areas as well, I doubt it's a huge loss for them either.
Okay. Yeah, so for my interest in Chabahar was because we've been writing about how Chabahar is important for Afghanistan and for their strategic autonomy, because they are totally dependent on Karachi, and so that will help Afghanistan. So just to add to that point, it gives an alternative route to Afghanistan and Central Asia. It is only 1,500 kilometers from Mumbai, the Chabahar port, which is about a day's sailing time. And then there on, it is another 800 kilometers by road to a place called Zaranj on the border of Afghanistan and Iran. So 800 kilometers by road, and from there on, the Indian built road connects to a place called Delaram, which is again further connected to this Garland Road in Afghanistan, which links all its important cities from Kunduz, Mazar-e-Sharif, right up to Herat. So that is one important road, which sort of the lifeline of Afghanistan, if I may say. And this new access gives it a totally new dimension, right? So it's not only connected to Karachi port, it is now connected to another sea head in Chabahar. So that way it connects India to Afghanistan, and also this highway is part of the Asian highway, and it in turn links with the road network in Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan and Tajikistan. So all those things are the opportunities that get opened up to India. So that's why we were sort of looking at it from an Afghanistan point of view and India's access to Central Asian markets point of view. So going ahead, yeah, go ahead, Sumitha.
No, and like the Joint Secretary said, his own term was that the international North-South corridor would be a force multiplier of the Chabahar bilateral and the port as well, because you can connect into other Trans-Asian or, Euro-Asian networks on land.
So, Sumitha, this the agreement which is signed, it's you mentioned in the at the start that it's just the beginning, right? So, in the past as well, we've had a lot of these execution concerns, and even Iran, I remember, was distinctly not happy because of that India kept putting this off at a later point of time. So, what are these execution concerns that Iran had and continues to have?
I think there are concerns on both sides. It's just that sometimes one party is a bit more vociferous about voicing their concerns, about it. I remember there was a very good Mint piece detailing exactly listing, because you don't really get to see that otherwise, listing these immediate irritants, which I believe now that we have the basic commercial contract, it's been hashed out, hopefully, included, from... So here's the deal. When the MOU was signed in May last year, so it's been exactly a one-year journey, which I think for Indian, in Indian terms, is I think quite an impressive task by the government in a sense. Mm-hmm. And I think reinforcing that, the Prime Minister Modi came with this idea that he would get this transit track online in some form or the other in his terms. So you had the MOU, but at the time of the signing of the MOU, the Iranians did not reveal that Chabahar had the port had been leased out to an Iranian company called Arya Bandar. Mm-hmm. And so what happened was for the next 5 months, you didn't hear anything much. Mm-hmm. It's because the Indian side realized that this had to be, you had to get back to the drawing table altogether, since there was no way the company could be out of the picture. And I think from precisely October, because that was when I was in Tehran, and that's when I realized. I will be honest, I wanted to actually make the trip and even head to Chabahar to figure out what's exactly going on. I mean, especially in terms of you read so much about it in the media. I mean, is something happening? Are there people there? So there were no Indians. There was no sort of a setup, no office, nothing. There was no Indian any sort of diplomatic presence or commercial presence at the time when I went, and that's the last week of October. And when I actually met some embassy officials, they told me that the first technical talks round between the special purpose vehicle, which was created on the Indian side, between JNPT and the Kandla Port Trust, Jawaharlal Nehru Port Trust and Kandla Port Trust, that group would be meeting the Arya Bandar guys only in that week, the last week of October. Mm-hmm. So if you look at it now, it's actually taken exactly 8 months for us to get to this line, which I think is even more impressive than the one-year timeline. And it's been a lot of back and forth of discussion just within this 7-8 months, with even a point in February where Foreign Secretary Jai Shankar had to intervene and Zarif had to intervene. You had people at every level, at the highest of them all as well, intervening to push things forward. And some of these irritants included, things like what fines would the Indian side pay for a day's delay? So it gets really tricky when you come down to the nitty-gritties and getting everyone on board, so those were some of the dynamics that played out in the last year.
Okay, cool. That's interesting. So let's go beyond Chabahar now and talk about India-Iran relations in general. So you, as part of your scholarship work at Takshashila, you were mapping out India's response to Iran's rising global status. So where do you think this relationship is now headed? And what has been the change in Iran after these sanctions have started to get lifted?
Okay, just for the folks who are like, what the hell are these guys talking about? I'm just going to I thought I would just pull up. So this is, I hope you can see this. I'm just sharing a quick snapshot of, and I believe Pranay created this, of my report, which was a scenario exercise on the India-Iran relationship for a certain window of time.
Can you maximize it? It's still...
No, it's, sorry.
Okay, you can just drag it, make it bigger, sort of. Zoom in or so.
Okay, let me try. But it's actually big on my screen, so I don't know what to
do. Go ahead.
Okay, so it's this box here, compliance, which I had put out as the most highly highly likely scenario, where Iran would secure a nuclear deal and sanctions would technically be lifted, and we're still in the process of going through that, as we can see even 6 months later, that we have certain payment channel issues. And of course, his regional influence is pretty much, as shown, it's on the higher side. So the regional influence is intact, and we're talking about influence in the sense of the Middle East and its, you know, its power centers or proxy centers, so to speak. And based on how Iran was behaving in that box, you have a plan of action for India, and I did prioritize the transit plans and fast-tracking them. Along with, obviously, you know, you had the oil equation and amping up of oil imports and further coordination on Afghanistan and Pakistan as well. Since in the last 3 to 4 years, certain terrorist groups seeking or being harbored in Pakistan also hurting Iranian security forces at the eastern border. So I think these are some of the top things that I had visualized, in a sense. And apart from that, of course, stepping up security, as mentioned, you know, coordinating on Afghanistan and Pakistan, I think, especially on the Afghanistan bit, they've discussed it again this time on stepping up security and defense cooperation. I'm hoping that's one area that India and Iran can at least seek ways to work together again, though I think... It's a very different scenario from a Northern Alliance sort of common goal. So let's see how that works out.
Yeah. So, Sumitha, this is the deal, right? Now, Iran as such, after 2012, once the sanctions were there, or even sometime before that, it was having very few options because it was sort of isolated from the international economy. Now that it has more freedom, it has potentially, from a realist Iranian point of view, it has a lot more options opened up for it. And as you know, there are no obligations, no morals in the world of international relations. So why is it, so in that sense, Iran has more options and it does not need to necessarily deal with India. It can have many other countries working with it as well. And that is where I think this Chabahar deal plays a role as well, and the other agreements, that it seals something which is significant and hence says to Iran that India is also an important partner in its journey to reintegration in the economy. Do you see it differently? Does Iran now, in the newspapers, do you read that they are ready to explore other options and export oil, etc., in other countries as well?
I think, on the first level, it's Iran's Asian customers were the ones who, even if it was, let's say, 2% or 10% of the energy mix, but they still route from Iran. So Iran's goodwill is still intact for these Asian customers. And then those are China, India, Japan, and South Korea.
Okay.
And you will see these are the four who very positive things are generally spoken about.
Did these four countries continue throughout the sanction period as well?
Yes, the way India did, because interestingly, I forget the exact section in the American authorization bill, but there was no exact cap. There was no amount that this is how much you needed to reduce it by. So it was more of an emotional, then the Americans would say, oh, okay, too much, or Hillary would visit, and then, okay, everyone would, like, you know, clamp them. It was always in a very... touch and go sort of situation. So everyone's managed to hold, still draw a bit from Iran. That's definitely a given. No one, including China and India, Japan and South Korea. of course, they were looking to diversify in those 2 years and working very hard towards it, especially I think Japan and the East Asian economies were trying much more harder, because it's difficult for India to shut off a complete source. So that's how the Asian scenario is working out. So the Iranians are definitely thankful. I mean, they're at the same time, I mean, these maybe have been the guys voting against them, you know, in the UN and the IAEA, but the goodwill, which I heard repeatedly in Iran, is intact in a sense. So which is why when I specifically asked about Chabahar, even when I visited in the end of October and first week of November, I was clearly told India is our first choice. I mean, those are very very diplomatic usage of words. It's, you know, India is our first choice, but dot, dot, dot. You know, so that's how it was there. But, you know, China is pursuing very aggressively, and, you know, I mean, they have the means, definitely. They can get it done faster, you know, deep pockets. But I also heard a bit about how their way of doing business was not as appreciated as the Indians would be. So it's... So that sort of a game, I think, has always been at play. But in general, the goodwill is intact, in a sense.
Okay.
And I think there's no real fear of us now, suddenly the deal being, you know, pulled off from under our feet. I don't think yet that's something.
So you were talking about how India is managing the transition from its end as well. So now what I see is sort of India always... The term used to describe India's relation in West Asia is called the balancing act, right? Where India tried to maintain relationships with almost all the countries there. And actually, we didn't have adversarial relations with any country in the Western Asian sphere. But all of that was made possible to an extent because we stuck to lower levels of engagement. Nothing was done high profile, etc., right? So now we are actually changing that game, right? So this is a big thing. We are advertising, going everywhere that we are interacting with Iran. Also, we are all amping up our involvement with Saudi Arabia, etc., right? So now sort of we are moving from this low equilibrium to a high equilibrium transition in Western Asia, which India will have to manage. So one of the important consequences of that is the Shia-Sunni dynamic internally as well, right? So India is the second largest Shia Muslim population in the world, even ahead of Iraq. And it has India has generally been a peaceful place. There haven't been any sectarian conflicts. Whereas in Pakistan, which has tried to arbitrate between Kingdom of Saudi Arabia and Iran, many times these relationships with Iran and Saudi Arabia have been coterminous with rise in extremism internally. So that's also a consideration that India needs to manage as it increases its involvement in West Asia. Do you think the same? Did you have this in your in mapping India's response to an increasing global status of Iran as well?
I think on the Shia-Sunni equation, I've generally preferred not play it up in the internal context because like you mentioned, you know, India is not facing a crisis like in Pakistan where there are actual terrorist groups like Lashkar-e-Jangvi literally slaughtering. I mean, it's very obvious who they're targeting and which sections of the community, etc. Something which I think in Iran is registered, and there's one particular group which is active in its eastern border, Jaish-ul-Adl, which is harbored within Pakistani territory, which also sort of has learnt lessons from Lashkar-e-Jangvi, etc., and doing the same, hitting the security forces, the Iranian security forces. So I think there's another shared concern, which is why I think which should bring India and Iran closer together as well, looking at this equation. Now, looking at the larger region, looking at India's interactions with the power centers in the Middle East, the Saudis, the Israelis, now the Iranians, even the UAE, which has demonstrated quite a bit of tact on its own, I think we've only stepped it up to a medium level now, even maybe not yet medium. I think we're now finally in a direction where we have realized we should engage a bit more than just meetings or exchanges. And you know, there's more to be done, or just that Indians are a migrant labor population there, etc. So going beyond that and trying to see what common interests and goals are there. And I think each of these countries do realize that India has equally shared relationships with their adversaries. And I think they keep this in mind, especially if you look at it. I mean, India interacts with the Israelis and actually has a much more substantial relationship with the Israelis than with Iranians. But you don't really hear much from the Iranian side, you know, complaining about that. The only bit I ever heard was, please don't let them use your satellites, because we actually did assist once, I believe, in 2008 or so. So that was, and that was a very random concern which someone actually just told me. I mean, we're okay, we're all cool about you guys talking to everyone else. I mean, I don't think we're insecure in this relationship. So, but just this, just don't do any satellite launches for these days. So, you know, it's very specific things. And that's the other thing. We haven't yet directly, if India, I think the game changer is if India decides to intervene directly in any of these conflicts, whether it's a Syria or a Yemen, which hasn't happened yet. I mean, there is no direct stake for us. We also know that given our own population in this region, there'll be a big target on their backs if we go behind any of these other extremist elements in the region as well. So I think right now, I wouldn't worry too much about the whole, the overall, the grand plan or how this whole thing moves ahead. I think we'll take it one step at a time.
Yeah, that's an important distinction you make, that unless India gets involved there in the conflicts, probably it's on the safer side, because we need to keep in mind West Asia at some point of time was a very important consideration for India. In fact, in the in Nicholas Blairel's book on India-Israel, he mentions that the Israel-Palestine issue was so important to India when Saudi Arabia was not the center of the Islamic world. There were two censor motions in the Indian parliament on India's stance regarding Israel. That's very significant. There are very few foreign policy issues which can end up as censor motions in the Lok Sabha. So it was an important part there then, so, and it can be emotive at times. So as long as India is not getting involved in the military conflicts there, as you said, probably it is okay to do the balancing act and it won't be setbacks from other countries.
Also, I believe it's today that Nitin, I believe, is in Israel, and he tweeted on how the Israelis see Saudi Arabia as a stabilizer. So, you know, things in the Middle East, they're all balls up in the air. So I think we need to be as savvy and as fast as to catch all of them and keep moving. I mean, that's the way to go about it, because what the situation is today will not be the dynamic tomorrow. It's just...
Okay, so now that we've discussed sort of broadly about India, Iran, etc. So since you visited there, why don't you quickly share some of your impressions there? I only read about Iran in the graphic novel Persepolis recently, in fact, about how the 1979 revolution changed lives there, etc. So, but what were your impressions? If you could quickly share in 5 minutes, it would be great.
I mean, there are also some really fantastic serials, Iranian productions, which are period dramas, which are doing really well. One is Sherzad. I think if people are into that sort of thing, should start watching it.
Is it on YouTube?
It's online. It's online. I will tell you that much. Sherzad. So you know, you can get it. So I thought, because when people hear Chabahar, I get this feeling, or maybe I got this feeling that it's just, like, what is Chabahar? It's on this coastline which no one really talks about. You don't hear much about it, so it has to be some barren land, backward rural, like what's going on there, and you know, and we land up there to build this port. So, because I want to show that this is, it's not something new. It's an up and running, a city by Iranian standards.
Can you share the screen? Are you sharing the screen?
Yeah, I'm sorry about this. I think it's coming. Okay. So I'm just going to take you all through some of my, because I think these pictures convey what the setting is. Like, what is this port? Where is it? What's happening? What all are we going to build? What sort of amenities will be, you know, Indians who land there get? It's not that bad. just to make that picture very clear. So this was only a shot which I could get from a civilian zone, to say, because I needed permits to get into the ports and maritime organizations in authorities area and get into the port, so I couldn't do that. But there's a whole, what you see in front is one arm of the U, which is, you see the second one behind, where you have two refinery, oil storage bunkers in the background. So that whole U is what is the Shahid Beheshti port. Shahid Beheshti is named after the politician who was actually the second guy after Khomeini, after the 79 revolution. So this is what the port looks like now. That's just some closer views of... So these are the size of it. Like, mostly these really mid-sized, you know, ships and boats. And you spotted maybe like two or three of such bigger ships. So clearly business is not... it's not in one of the primary ports for Iran. I mean, Bandar Abbas is definitely way ahead. Mm-hmm. This was just one of the entranceways, which actually reads the Iranian ports.
You're not moving to the next slides here, so can't see. Are you moving them?
Yeah, I actually am. I'm not sure why it's not.
Okay.
I'm hoping that on the YouTube, on the final product, it's moving.
Mm. Yeah.
Then I do have another picture of, to show you the infrastructure, because I think it's important to know, to acknowledge that there is a basic infrastructure in place, and the roads, when it comes to Iran, and you realize that there may be only one road connecting, one arterial road connecting one point A to B, like a city to another city, but that one road will be in top condition.
Mm-hmm.
So, which is why there is a need for infrastructure, but the existing ones which are there are not too bad either.
Mm-hmm.
So this picture is of one of the road which you, there's only one road from the airport which is located at a nearby village called Konark, and then you take a cab and you come in, and then you see this is whole Chabahar free zone advertised everywhere. The free zone, the free trade zone, has been there since 1992. So just to give you a picture that this has been up, and I mean they've been waiting for some time for greater investments to come in. This is the road towards the city of Chabahar. And another shot from an old monument, a fort on the side. So that's just trying to show you that all this infrastructure is ready and waiting. There's just a police outpost along the road again. Just one of the signs to show.
Unfortunately, Sumitha, we are not
able. Yeah, you can't see it, right? Okay. So anyway, this is the last.
I probably could have stopped the slide share and started again, but...
It's okay. So I've anyway reached the last one just to show the Chabahar Free Trade Zone, but... That's about it. So, like, talking about anecdotal observations and things, I think some interesting exchanges, like we spoke about this whole Iranian-Balochi, the strained relationship with, you know, Tehran. There's always this constant feeling of the other and, you know, us. Something I realized today because I was reading more about it is how I never saw anything in Balochi. So apparently the Baloch identity is sort of not to be encouraged or displayed, except that they wear, what's visible is their outfit. It's the shalwar kameez that the men wear and even the women wear. But in general, I think in contrast to a China-Pakistan dynamic in Pakistan and Balochistan, just generally chatting, I spent about, you know, 4 or 5 hours per day just sitting in a car with my guide come driver, you know, so he was only the main person for me to extract information from or get a conversation going, and he was Balochi, and I think, I mean, very randomly, we were just talking about some common things and how there are Pakistanis here, a lot of families on both sides, you know, everyone, there are Pakistanis working this side, you know, there's Urdu, there are people who speak Urdu in my hotel, they assigned one of the Urdu, from one of the Pakistani waiters so that he could assist me with, you know, in linguistic things. And then my driver just very casually asked me, you know, why are you Indians not here? I mean, this doesn't make sense. Like, why are you guys not here yet? So at least I would like to think that it's not a very negative feeling towards Indians, because I think there's a more cultural and you know, affinity towards the subcontinent than the people, the Baloch population feel towards the regime as such. So I'm hoping that dynamic should play out when we eventually get there. I think if you want some random Iranian conversations, which I've generally had in airplanes, and it really astounded me how popular air travel was. I was quite shocked with the number of people from a airport like the tiny, like the small one in Chabahar to Tehran or Shiraz. Or, I mean, it's very popular because, you know, fuel is, it's cheap. So the people benefit in the sense that everyone's traveling a lot by air. The rail is not developed as much, which is why, again, the Chabahar-Zayedan rail link makes sense. The connectivity within Iran is also not as much as it should be. And I think when it comes to conversations was on which Indians, once they realized I was from India, like which Indian would they refer to in their, you know, living memory. So it's ranged from it wasn't Mahatma Gandhi, it was more about Indira Gandhi. And that visit, especially for those who were around during the Shah's period. So it was all about how Mrs. Gandhi was such an admirable figure and, you know, meeting the Shah and all that jazz. So I heard a lot about her. And very interestingly, I had a random conversation. It took sort of extremely random for me because the guy I associated with was a huge fan of Vishwanathan Anand.
Oh, wow.
And that, yeah, that took me. Shatranj in Iran as well. And so that was very interesting because I associate sport-wise as wrestling or kabaddi that India and Iran actually, you know, you think come together to engage in, but, you know, he was very fascinated and remembered a particular match of Vishwanathan Anand, I think around 2002 when he was in Tehran with his mom. And his mom was in a very elegant sari and a very down-to-earth person. I mean, he had the details and was supremely excited to share that with me. So that's just some random observations, I think, just meeting.
I think you've been blogging about it as well.
Yeah, so I managed to put up I have three blogs on my website.
Okay, so guys, if you are interested in knowing more about Iran from an Indian perspective, check out Sumita's blog. So thanks, Sumita. I think we'll just open it out for questions if there are any on Twitter, and then we can close down. So Raman, can you unmute yourself? And if there are any questions, or if you have any questions, just shoot.
This has been a fascinating talk. We have a few questions. So I will take the first question from Vivek, and these questions came through the YouTube chat. So Vivek wants to know, can India access Caspian Sea oil as part of the agreements that we just signed, or is it a future possibility?
No, not yet. That's not at all a part of the current, any of the 12 agreements that have been signed. For now, I think that's...
Such a deal would require another... much more than bilateral cooperation. It will need a collaboration with the other Central Asian countries as well. Yes, and that has not yet happened. So it will take some time.
And then you have to think of, though Iran has a pretty decent pipeline infrastructure, so, I mean, I wouldn't say it's impossible, but let's get there first where we look at the Caspian Sea.
Okay.
Raman? Yes. So I guess Vivek got the answer. There are two questions. I'm clubbing them together. The questions are from Varun and Anjana. So Varun wants to know if the economic benefits of Chabahar port, what would be the economic benefits? And Anjana wants to know, apart from trade, apart from oil, what are the other major elements of Indian-Iran trade? What are the other commodities that are that we are trading, or the possibility that we can trade?
Okay. Quick thoughts on commodities on the second bit. Part of these agreements was the steel rail. So we already have a budding steel sales approach already going on with the Steel Authority of India and Iran Railways, if I'm not mistaken, is the Iranian party. Need to confirm that. So in the last 2 years, they were already trying to hash out, and then you had the sanctions lifted, and the Iranians were trying to pressure the Indian side by saying, hey, look, Turkey is offering cheaper, talking about other buyers who are offering cheaper costs, and then SAIL actually did reduce its prices and they renegotiated the contract. But that was in the initial stage when sanctions would be lifted, and there's this whole hoopla about European customers coming in, which, as we see, it's going to take its time. So that was one aspect. We are trading in steel. I believe there's also within this agreement for aluminium. I'm not sure. I think we can, if we check again the list of the 12 bits, there's a very interesting infographic that the MEA released on Twitter. I'm sure it's online other spaces as well, but it's a very helpful and handy infographic which has all the 12 agreements mapped. So I think that would be a good, interesting reference point. On the economic, I guess, benefits, like the cost-cutting aspect.
Right.
Of course.
Yeah, I think cost-cutting is definitely the one, because it used to be a very circuitous route in order to get to Central Asia before that, right, around Europe, and now it helps to go directly from Chabahar, which is one day sailing time. So.
Yeah, I think, and they've already pretty much tested the upper half of the route, talking heading towards like Central Asia and the Caucasus, like that direction. So I think they did a test run. It's about 40 to 50% lesser time. So that's
I think great. Praveen Swamy has an article today on how the link has been developed to Astra.
Yeah, he starts with the lead is based on that test in 2014, which didn't generate as much news because because infrastructure is not that sexy. The other aspect, it could get shorter, is if Mundra, a Gujarat port also gets involved. Mundra is being built by Adani. So once that comes into play, I mean, you wouldn't even have to do Mumbai. It's much more closer, much, much more closer. So I think those are the whatever's being chopped down in terms of time and money.
Okay.
Great. So the next question is from Adarsh Matthew. And Adarsh wants to know, if the Chabahar port and the future rail link to Afghanistan can actually connect China, One Belt, One Road, and the Maritime Silk Route?
Can I take this question?
Adarsh,
I don't think India would want to connect it because India would... In these regions, I think India thinks it has, it can leverage its own supply chains and it doesn't need to be dependent on the Chinese one. So I think it would be a conscious effort for India to develop an alternative and convert One Belt, One Road to many belts, many roads instead of that. So that would be the thing that India would want to play. I don't know. What do you think, Sumitha?
Well, I mean, that is what India would... That's the ideal case where India would stave off any such attempts. But I believe Abdullah, the Afghan, the CEO, the chief executive officer in China, has come on board of OBOR as well. And I think CPEC in particular is happy to link into that. So Afghanistan is willing. I'm sure Iran would not say no. Because Chinese President Xi Jinping has already been there. And I'm sure this is what they also spoke about. So it depends on do the players around that we're dealing with want it or not. I guess it'll be their prerogative if it's their land or their territory. So we'll have to see how this plays out. But again, like I said, I believe we don't need to play catch up. We need to acknowledge that the reach that China has in the heartland in Central Asia and some of these countries surrounding us does exist. And we play to our strengths and I guess work on what we can and get that moving. So these 12 agreements are very important and get that moving.
Yeah, true. So Raman, next question.
Yes. So the next question is from Sushoban Farida, and he wants to know how are these agreements between India and Iran perceived in Iranian media, in television, in newspaper, and especially if we could get an insight into what is the middle class thinking about these agreements and Iran opening up.
Okay, so there's middle class thinking on Iran opening up, which is at the point that I was in Iran was during the positive phase, because it was just 4 months into the JCPOA being signed, though the sanctions were lifted in January, but there was the impending lifting. But I think today it's a bit different given how much it's taken almost a year. And in lay terms, I think the middle class or the Aam Aadmi of Iran would not have seen any direct benefits or experienced any benefits yet. And you still see that in reports from within Iran. Now, talking about the India relationship, I think it's, I wouldn't say that they're avidly watching the Chabahar port deal or any such thing. Again, this is just a signing of the, we're at the starting line. So maybe once, even if they see things moving forward, it's an opportunity. I mean, it creates jobs for Iranians. I think that's one of the first trips that Rouhani did in, when he became president was heading to Chabahar and having a rally there and talking about job creation, removing unemployment, reducing poverty. So, this is Rouhani's pitch, and he's definitely working towards that. And transit was a major platform that he championed all across the region in Central Asia and, Russia and in India and with regard to India. So these are many aspects that even he wants to work. And I think maybe no one, the layman in Iran is not saying, yes, it's awesome that India is, doing this. But perhaps if they see the benefits, then, it's definitely a positive. It's more goodwill for India's efforts. And I think that's what should ultimately be what we get from this.
Okay. And Pranay, if I could extend this question to you, did you notice how the U.S. think tanks or policymakers are viewing this new closeness between Iran and India?
Yeah, Raman. Actually, there were a few news items here in New York Times and others which were saying that in U.S. is keeping a close watch on how Iran is interacting with India. But yeah, the from a U.S. Perspective, they would want to say that we are keeping a close watch because they keep a close watch everywhere in the world. So they can do that. But that's been the general rhetoric here about just keeping an eye on how close India is to Iran. Nothing else apart from that.
I think if I may just tack on to that, is yes. I think the India-US, see, there's a different phase in the India-US relationship when you're talking about 2005 to 2010, the initial stages of, the nuclear deal and, feeling each other out and then understanding where each other stands and what their ideas and what their understanding of the world and the global system is. But I think today the relationship is clearly in the last 2 years. I think it's in a much more mature stage, a much more secure sort of a stage. If nothing else, I go back to this 2012 statement when in the sidelines of the NAM, of the non-aligned movement summit, when Manmohan Singh, Prime Minister Manmohan Singh met with the Afghan-Iranian leaders back then, and that's when they reinitiated discussions on Chabahar. And when the State Department spokeswoman then was prodded and pressed like how Nisha Biswal was also done yesterday, I mean, pushed on this whole aspect of India and Iran, all they're engaging, isn't that, detrimental to America's plans, etc. I mean, she said, this is, if Afghanistan wants to connect with the region, this is a regional matter, and, it's up, and it's left to them. So I think that was one of the very clear statements on how this was a neighborhood-related issue. And I think pitching it as Afghanistan's economic prospects and stability is what's working here. And I think the Americans acknowledge that.
Okay. That's interesting. We have, this is not a question, but Praveen and Shushoban were very interested in the pictures that we were trying to share. So would it be possible after this talk if we can have those pictures, can they be shared?
Okay, yeah, sure. No issues. They're not classified. I'll definitely share them.
Great. So I think we've run out of time now. So thanks a lot, Raman. So thanks, Sumitha, for joining in from Singapore. I'm sure it must be late night by now.
Almost bedtime. It's fine.
Yeah. Thanks a lot. Thanks for sharing your ideas on this topic. And so for all the others who've joined, thanks for joining in. And until next week, it's bye. And see you on another interesting topic next week. Thank you. Yeah. Good night.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you. Good night.